How do you do?
Hey folks, it's Tom and Bill here. We just wanted to explain why we're showing up in your podcast feed on the wrong day.
It's a bonus episode.
Or at least half a bonus episode. Or a third of half of a bonus episode. You see, Frankenstein Minute is on Patreon, and in honor of Karloff Week 2019, we've recorded a special bonus episode just for our Patreon supporters who contribute at the friend level, which is $2 a month.
Come on, $2 a month. For that low price, you get every episode of Frankenstein Minute a day early, and you'll also get access to bonus episodes, like the one you're going to hear a bit of here.
We're going to talk about our top 10 Karloff films, which is going to be spread out over a few bonus episodes.
We're not going to play the whole thing now, just a bit to whet your appetite. If you listen to this and you just simply have to hear the rest, it's going to cost you $2.
So, without further ado, here's the first few minutes of our bonus episode, Karloff the Uncanny, Part 1.
It's alive!
We're about to unfold the story of Frankenstein.
Quite a good scene, isn't it?
Well, hello!
Oh. I thought I was alone. Good evening.
Well, we warned you.
You've been warned. Welcome to the first bonus episode of Frankenstein Minute in honor of Karloff Week 2019.
Yes.
Thought we'd do something special. So we're going to talk about Boris Karloff. Specifically, we're going to talk about...
For a very long time.
Probably not as long as we could.
No.
We're going to talk about Boris Karloff, specifically our favorite Boris Karloff movies.
Yes, our top 10 favorite.
Yep.
So I have my 10 and Bill has his 10.
We have not revealed them to one another.
This has been
although
kept
mine's
in
sitting
the,
right in front of me, you probably peeked.
Nope, we kept it in a mayonnaise jar on Funkin' Wagnall's porch.
So the only thing that left to be done in preparation for this momentous occasion is the ritual
coin flip,
the coin toss, to determine who's going to go first. So do I do it? Here's what I want to know. Do I do it like this and then like that?
Sure.
Okay,
like you just did.
All right. Do you want to call it now?
I'll call it heads.
Oh, boy. Heads.
Oh,
so
see,
Tom is going to go first.
I go first. All right. Well, coming in
keep the coin just in case we need
in case
it for anything else.
Settle an argument.
Never settle an argument.
Can't hurt. Well, my number 10... released November 5th, 1932 from MGM at 68 minutes is The Mask of Fu Manchu.
Nice.
I wasn't sure this would make my top 10.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd sent me to a website that pile in a bunch of data and it kind of chooses for you.
Mm-hmm.
This is the order that they're in is based upon that.
Yes, the preference revealer.
Is that what it's called?
I'll put a link to it in the something or other.
Yeah,
notes or whatever.
I usually don't do these kind of lists personally, and so I struggled with trying to find. I started with 30.
Yeah,
and whittled it down.
27 or something like that. You said.
Yeah, I whittled it down.
This is great that you mentioned this on the first one because it's a great introduction to what it is we're trying to do. So the way this works, you just give it the list, paste it in, and then it asks you questions. Which one do you like better?
Which one do you prefer over
this? This one or that one? I was going to give examples, but
probably not.
They better not do that. A little too early. But I did the same thing. That's how I got my list.
Bookies in Vegas have a lot of money on what the top fives are going to
be. Yeah, exactly. That's true. That's true. Not too soon.
Yeah.
Yep. It's like we can still get our bets in.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. I just chose it because it always makes me laugh.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of it that is very, very, very problematic in this day and age.
I mean, almost all of it.
Almost all of it is racially insensitive in one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
It goes both directions, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a famous line where Karloff actually says, "We must kill the white man and take all of his women." pretty strong for 32, I think. It's still pretty rough stuff.
Yeah. The only thing I noticed that that doesn't happen, which is a surprise, is Karloff doesn't do the Asian stereotype voice.
No.
It's his voice.
Just
sounds like him talking.
He's camping it up a little bit.
Sure.
I think he and Myrna Loy, who plays his daughter, realized the only way to get through this and not look like an idiot is to kind of do it a little tongue-in-cheek,
mm-hmm.
kind of camp it up.
Yep.
That works.
Mm-hmm.
They were right. It was the only way this would ever work. So he's having fun. Mm-hmm. He's having a ball. You know, he's in drag, and apparently it's a Chinese woman's wedding gown that he's
wearing. Is that right?
That's what I've read. And I don't
That's
know.
That's pretty good.
Some of this comes off of IMDb, so God only knows how accurate that
yep.
is.
That's right.
I intend to take that with a grain of salt. He's just, you know, having a ball.
Mm-hmm.
Just being silly. It's got what you would normally associate with a serial. The kind of thrills.
It does, yeah.
Yeah, it's sort of like one of those condensed Flash Gordon where they took the 12 chapters and cut it down to an hour and a half, so it's nearly incomprehensible.
Yes.
So that's kind of how this plays out.
Yep. I think that's its strength.
It is. Yeah. It is. It moves very fast. It's very silly. You don't have a lot of time to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
This is the film we were talking about, who was on the table in Frankenstein going
right.
up, and whether it was actually Strick Fadden
mm-hmm.
Doubling for Karloff or not. And this is the film where, for sure, you can actually see that it's not Karloff in the shot where there's a big lightning arc shooting across the room through this sword, and it's scary
mm-hmm.
in and of itself.
Yep. No surprise.
No surprise.
I've been watching a lot of Boris Karloff movies coming up to
yeah.
this, and I watched this one, the other week, and it's so obvious that it's not him. I didn't realize it was that obvious.
It's even on
a little TV screen.
Yeah.
I wasn't watching it on a huge screen.
I was watching it on my laptop.
And, can you imagine in the theater, people were like,
whoa.
Is that meant to be the same guy?
I think a wiser decision would have had his back to the camera.
Yeah, something.
Whatever.
There were choices to that didn't. But
well, this had a troubled production, as is,
oh, yeah.
I guess, fairly typical at MGM.
Okay.
Karloff, first day, asked to see the script and was literally laughed at. script was changing daily.
Yeah.
And that shows. But that's, again, typical. Ask the Marx Brothers. That happened all the time.
Yeah.
Buster Keaton found it immensely frustrating.
Yeah, he didn't like MGM
No,
much.
He did not. And if you've seen the films he made there, there's a good reason why he didn't like MGM very much.
Yeah.
And this had two directors. I think after the first week or so, it started as... a guy named Charles Braben, don't know much about him, didn't bother to look him up.
Nope.
Because he was fired.
Okay.
And replaced with Charles Vidor. I also don't know a whole lot about him.
He didn't go by King?
He did not go by King. It's
okay.
Not the same guy.
To hell with him.
Yep, fuck him. Interesting, one of the screenwriters was Edgar Allan Wolfe, who was also noted for The Wizard of Oz as one of the
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
All right.
And
you said Edgar Allan. I thought you were going somewhere else.
No.
Because
he'll come up. It'll come up for sure. Probably numerous times.
Yeah.
Karloff made this in between The Old Dark House and Before the Mummy.
Man.
Yeah, he was a 32.
It's cranking him out.
Late 31 into 32 was a busy time.
Mm-hmm.
Even apart from the horror films he made a ton of other movies at the same time. Some more gangster things.
Mm-hmm.
Scarface came out in that era.
Yeah.
He was a busy guy.
When did he make Scarface? Did he make it 32 or was it? I was convinced that he made it before
Frankenstein.
Before Frankenstein. In fact, I think I might have said that on one of our podcasts.
Yeah, see,
but
I'm
it comes
not...
out in 32, so I'm guessing not. But
well, he shot Frankenstein in late summer of 31.
Yeah. So it could have been.
Who
knows?
Yeah.
But then again, he's hardly in Scarface. So.
He's got just a few scenes. He's memorable.
Mm-hmm. He's got a memorable death in that
one. He has a memorable death in that. Yes, definitely.
It's weird to be talking about Boris Karloff movies because everything we've just mentioned, every time I think, okay, can I talk about this?
Should we not even say it? Yeah. Right. Yeah, I don't know how many times I wanted to reference Criminal Code or something like that in the past, and we couldn't.
Yeah, that's true.
Because we said...
Well, that's what it is. It's all spilling out now.
Yes.
Now we can talk about Boris Karloff.
This is... the better part of...
That's why it's called Karloff Week.
Yeah,
we're just
going
to do this. This episode is 1 week long. It's 168-hour marathon.
Yeah.
Probably not.
No, I doubt that.